Back in 2004, aspiring pro skier and friend of mine, Josh Dueck, broke his back when a flip on skis went tragically wrong. He ended up a T11 full paraplegic, which pretty much means that he had no feeling in his body from about this point down. Last year, we worked on a documentary film together called The Freedom Chair. And during filming, Josh just blew me away with what he was able to do on a sit ski. While we were out filming, the whole time Josh kept talking about wanting to go upside down on snow again. So here we are in Whistler, and we're gonna try and make it happen.
Hello. Let me get back to that story in a moment, but first, let me give you the backstory. Before I landed in a wheelchair, I was coaching some of the world's best young skiers. One day while we're out training, I decided to join them. I hiked up this in run, about 3/4 of the way up the top, and did a speed check. Found out that it wasn't going to be enough speed, so I went right back up to the very top. And as soon as I dropped in, I realized I was going a bit fast. But I assumed that as I came into the transition, that my speed would slow down and be all right. But when I came into the transition, I had a gut feeling it was going to be bad. And I had a split second where I could have bailed off to the side, and it was a battle of ego and intuition. And I didn't want to seem weak in front of the kids I was coaching. I sent it off the end of the jump, and as soon as I was in the air, I knew it was just trouble. All I could do was brace for impact. So let me give you a little more of a backstory. And I want to go back into my childhood a little bit. I grew up in this beautiful mountain town, Kimberley, BC, and when I was a kid, I loved playing outdoors. I especially enjoyed hanging out in the snow. And, you know, all the time I dreamt about, you know, going on adventures in the mountains, and there was a ski hill right in town, but skiing's a luxury my family couldn't afford. Now, fortunately for me, when I was 11 years old, there was a school field trip that went up to the hill, so I had my first taste of freedom. That summer, I got a bottle route, or a paper route, and returned some bottles, and saved up enough money to buy my first pair of skis. A few years later, I joined the local freestyle club, and for the first time in my life, I felt like I was really a part of something. You know, I love bumping, and I love jumping, and I love the people, and I love the travel, and I loved everything about it. And my goal was to one day represent Canada and go to the Olympics. However, financial constraints cut that dream short, and I was faced with some pretty tough choices, and I decided that I wanted to continue on in the ski world, and I carried on as a ski coach. And we'll cue that video. To be them could no catch on my pillar. We are love man for Nike and I love man for filler. Cause that's not the ways of ancient war gorilla. Me rather than to save all me sassipavilla. Then on a lonesome breezy Sunday morning, this maiden came to town. Me have a blacker sound. Oh, she's a cute and plus a sexy and surround. Sunlight catch her skin and lot of good for me to crown. This can be the best. Set up for the trick and went down the in run, and about halfway down the in run realized that I was going a bit faster than I expected, and off the end of the jump I panicked, and I did the front flip and it was huge. I cleared the 50-foot gap between the end of the jump and the start of the landing hill. I over rotated the front flip and completely overshot the landing hill. I fell over 100 vertical feet. That's like falling off the top of a 10-story building onto my face. When I regained consciousness, I remember looking up and seeing the shock in everybody's face. And I was super embarrassed and wondering why I couldn't move. They brought me down to the emergency room, and the doctor came in to reveal the prognosis, and He knew a bit about my story because I was coaching his kids, and he came in with a lightness about him. And he looked at me in the eyes and he said, "You're going to rock the world in a wheelchair." I knew what that meant. He said, "Before you know it, we're going to have you back in the mountains with all your friends riding a sit ski." In the darkest moment of my life, gave me hope. And they immediately flew me to Vancouver, and I had surgery the following day, and the whole time I was strapped to the backboard, I kept thinking these three things. Everything happens for a reason. Nothing happens we're not strong enough to deal with. And everything in my life has prepared me for this moment. And about a week later, I was able to send a message to all the freestyle community because it was important because I knew the ripple effect that my actions was having on everybody else. I told them I was going to be okay. Don't mourn my loss. Know that I'm going to be back riding a sit ski and be back in the mountains with you guys again one day soon. Now, I don't want to just glaze over the whole process of hospital and rehab because it was filled with peaks and valleys. But the one story that I remember and moment that changed my life was when this girl that I was crushing on quit her job, bought a one-way bus ticket, came to the hospital, and was there for me. And she is to this day. Very, very lucky man. Later that summer, I had figured out what I needed to in the rehab center. I moved back to Vernon, a community I'd only lived for a short while. There's my lady. Moved back to Vernon, a community I'd only lived for a short while, and it suddenly felt like home. And 9 months later, I learned how to ski again. And it was so much fun, you know, like the freedom that I experienced as a child, that connection with the mountains, it was all there. And a few weeks after that, I was invited to try out a ski race, and I was like, well, I don't know, ski racing is very counterculture from freestyle. But I went and had a look, and I saw this fenced-in run where I was told I can go as fast as I want. And I thought, what the heck, I'll give it a try. And I remember blasting down that hill, hair straight back, and I had a lot of fun. I crossed the finish line, looked to the scoreboard, and imagine my disappointment when I noticed that I was dead last by like 30 seconds. I was way out. But it reignited a competitive fire inside of me. I knew I wanted to be better. And from an old dream came a new goal. With 5 years to go, I wanted to be a Paralympian representing Canada in Vancouver 2010. So in order to do that, I needed to rally the community behind me. I needed their support, and they believed in me. Together, we made an impossible goal possible. We'll cue that next video.
In 2007, ended up winning the Canadian Championships. 2008, I earned a spot on the World Cup circuit. Got my ass handed to me every weekend. And I didn't like that very much. So I took what I learned, applied it over the summer, brought it to 2009, and won the World Championships, which was kind of crazy. Ended up coming back to Whistler from the World Championships and won the downhill there, which solidified me as one of the skiers that belonged with the best. And I was feeling good, and that just rolled me in quite nicely to the Paralympic Games in Whistler 2010 and brought home a silver medal for Canada, which was outstanding.
For yet another silver finish. Every one of his supporters were on their feet.
Now, going to the games and representing Canada was certainly a highlight in my life, but winning a medal wasn't the highlight of the games for me. know, the highlight for me was sharing that experience and sharing that journey with this community of people, the people that were there for me in the hardest times, that were there for me in the good times. And we felt so infinitely connected in that environment. It was amazing. It was the top of the world. Now, this is where the story turns a bit, and I wouldn't have seen this coming. In fact, nothing was there to prepare me for what was about to happen next. I hit what I call the Paralympic hangover. And, you know, my whole life, I'd been setting goals and I didn't even realize it. When I was younger, my goal was to fit in. When I was a skier, it was to be better. When I had my accident, it was to recover. When I wanted to be Paralympian, I wanted to be the best. And suddenly, my life was devoid of any goals. I became depressed, started drinking more. And I was no fun to be around. I didn't enjoy skiing, and competition meant nothing. And the worst of it all is you often fall hardest on those that you love the most. I nearly pushed my wife out of my life. It's tough times. But a year later, a good friend of mine called me up and said, "Hey, you think you can ride POW in your sit-ski?" And I said, "Yeah, do I think I can ride POW in my sit-ski?" I said, "Yeah, I can." And what started off as just a very modest idea, we completely blew the expectations off of what we thought was possible. We had a ton of fun, and it turned out to be an award-winning film called The Freedom Chair. And this is really where the idea of the backflip was born. And it started off as a casual conversation and turned into an epic adventure. And, you know, the first thing, you know, I knew it was possible, but it had never been done. I knew I wanted to do it. That was a motivator for me. But I had to assemble a team of people that I trusted to help me design and build the perfect venue. When I was able to do that, I needed to talk to my family and my wife. And Lacey was like, "You know what? If this is what you believe in and this is what you want, then I'll support you 100%. And that meant a lot. Threw it past my parents. My mom was like, "Oh, well, that sounds wonderful." I was pretty sure she had no idea what I was talking about. And in fact, when I showed her the video, I know she had no idea what I was talking about. For me, the motivation was to redeem a jump gone wrong. And I wanted to test myself if I could really differentiate the voices of ego and intuition. And after months of planning and preparation, I told the crew. So there's a very good chance that I won't even hit the jump. And in fact, the first couple of efforts, we backed away. But I also told the crew, I said, there's a very good chance that if I hit that jump, I'm gonna stomp a backflip. And we'll cue that video. I knew that deep, soft snow was going to leave me the biggest margin for error. Powder Mountain Snowcats decided to build me this big old backcountry booter, and then when the weather was right, obviously I knew it was time to send it. Felt. Allowing my intuition to guide me and not let fear define me was an incredibly liberating experience. The next time life challenges you, whether it be seemingly insurmountable adversity or incredible opportunity, how will you respond? Thank you very much.